What's up, everybody? Once again, it's Brandman Sean, and I have a very special episode for you guys today because I sat down with George Fakis of MyContractExplained.com, where you can get your contract explained in simple, basic terms if you're having struggles and troubles. Now, for this sit down, we went into three contracts that a lot of artists come across because there's popular music services of AWOL, Amuse, and United Masters, and there's seven interesting things that I pulled from our long sit down where you can get access to the whole thing in the description. But the seven things that I'll go through in this video, they're crazy. They're kind of crazy or interesting to say the least. So let's go ahead and get into it. Number one.
So this is like material that they can collect from you. So like this is information that they have the right to collect from you. So they can digitize and encode the recordings and related materials into digital files, including any related processes such as fingerprinting, to make any necessary modifications to the recording.
Fingerprints? Why exactly? I mean, that just seems a little bit too serious. But let's get into something that's a little bit more serious.
Things. So they may make material changes to the agreement according to their own discretion. They will let you know via email or within their own service whether the agreement has changed, but they do not always notify you in advance. In these cases, if you didn't know the agreement changed simply by continuing to use their service, you have now involuntarily accepted their changes officially. So that's another important point, is that if they change the agreement and you don't know that they changed the agreement, but you still keep using their services, that counts as you accepting the new terms.
Yeah. Agreement. I just love the fact that they said involuntarily officially.
right. No, I think actually I might
have. Well, I mean, that you said that. I like right. that, because that's what actually, that's what's happening. But it's yeah. I mean,
essentially, yeah.
Yeah, that's
involuntarily that's officially. Yeah.
Now that clip spoke for itself. And that contract that we were reading off of in that clip was the Amuse contract, but pretty much all of them have some version of that. So that's something just to keep in mind at the very least, because, man, I mean, what's the point of signing a contract if the thing can change without you knowing?
So let's keep going. Five, companies shall have the right to exploit the user content in any manner hereunder, free from adverse claim and without any obligation to make any payment of any nature to any person or entity other than the amounts payable to you here under. So what this means is that essentially if they figure out a way to exploit your user content in some way other than what is described in these conditions, they essentially don't owe you for that new exploitation that they've discovered. So for whatever way that they decide to kind of make a profit from your music, if it's not explicitly described in this agreement, then they don't actually owe you anything from that.
All right, so this is interesting for a few reasons. So let me break it down like this. One, I get it. Like anybody who's like, yo, man, they can figure out how to make money with my music and I not get paid, that's crazy. I know a lot of artists aren't gonna like to hear something like that, right? But it does list quite a few scenarios, and it's something that most people would see and say, yo, these are pretty much all the ways that I'm looking to make money anyway, or I don't know of any scenarios what didn't get covered, all right? But when you even think about it, MP3s didn't always exist, right? So we had times where it was tape cassettes, people were phasing out of tape cassettes and moving to CDs. MP3s weren't on people's mind, so you might be getting CD revenue and tape cassette revenue and all the other, you know, things that come top of mind for revenue at that time that are available when MP3s come out. Basically, the company is saying, yo, we might find this new medium, this new route, and start making money this way, and you aren't necessarily able to get the benefit of that financially. That's a weird aspect and loophole in the contract. It seems pretty interesting to see something like that listed, but it's not completely, you know, foreign in the music industry, because there's contracts where you might say, yo man, like, we're in the United States, why do y'all say in the entire universe, right? There's terminologies like that in some contracts where we're saying universe, not United States and another country or the world. No, the entire universe. They're factoring for all these aspects for a reason, and that language is there for a reason when it comes to the rights that the company gets. But I move on. Let's see what's next.
That'd be a fair enough assessment.
Yeah, pretty much. So essentially that latter part of that comment is going to be more important. Once submitted for potential delivery to third party, user no longer has rights to that content or the right to grant other third parties any rights to that content. So basically the content that you give to the company to deliver to a potential third party, as soon as it's actually submitted, the user doesn't have any rights to that piece of content that United submitted to a third party.
Now, again, that's something that might rub artists the wrong way. And I understand that perspective. But on a business side of things, you don't want to be able to make a promise to one of your partners, let's say the NBA, NFL, Coca-Cola, whoever, saying that you have the rights to use this, right, and pitch this to them. Well, all of a sudden, you might be in the background as an artist pitching this to a competitor. Right. So once they start to pitch things, they withhold rights. Like, there's an understandable side from a business perspective, because that just helps them stay in good standing with whoever their partners are. Right. That's just one aspect of it. And I should mention that all of these things should be looked at from multiple perspectives when you read contracts. One, you want to read it on the most literal level that you might interpreted at. But two, you want to get as cynical as possible. And most lawyers are going to get cynical with it, because although some things might not be likely, although some things might not be the intent of the company or whoever you're doing a contract with, it's kind of in the best interest to be cynical, because it still might happen. And a lawyer is all about, like, hey, let's create insurance, right? So this particular situation right here, I understand, again, from a business perspective, where, look, that's kind of protecting themselves and how they deal with artists. But the artist, again, you, of course, you can have plenty of reasons where you might be salty in losing your rights. That's just what comes with it, though. Are you going to pitch? Do you want to put in serious work to make brand deals happen and things like that? You know, each his own.
Yeah, you retain all your ownership, but AWOL reserves the right to decide not to distribute specific music if they don't want to, or if they deem it inappropriate or unsatisfactory. These are vague terms, so again, these could mean anything. And they could basically take your song, and if they deem for whatever reason that you shouldn't be credited for whatever reason, they can just... they can choose not to credit you for like one of your best work.
All right, so the only thing I want to focus on from that particular clip is language like inappropriate, unsatisfactory, reasonable. What do they mean? You don't really know. It's subjective language. So a lot of times you want to watch out for stuff like that in your contracts, because it allows people to do things where you can't necessarily move against them, because it's up for interpretation. And likely the people who have more power, better lawyers, could win in those scenarios against you, because they know how to twist and turn all the knobs that happen when it comes to legalese. So, point is, if somebody intends for something but happen to use subjective language, figure out what they mean by it, make it more specific to what it's actually supposed to be saying versus leaving it ambiguous. Or, hey, maybe you're on the side where that ambiguous language benefits from you, so you don't want to do it, whatever, right? But just understand that subjective language could lead to positives and negatives. So we got two more of these seven crazy slash weird things that you should be aware of in these particular contracts. Here's another one.
So I marked this part. Later in this paragraph, they give us the statement, additionally, user acknowledges and agrees that company receives many submissions, some of which may be similar or maybe similar to content being independently developed by company, and company is free to work with artists with similar submissions or proceed with developing its own content without any obligation to user. So I thought that this was an interesting section to use because, or to include, because if you think about what they're saying, essentially what they're saying is that basically in the event that they consider or listen to your music but choose not to go with you as an artist, and then 2 weeks later you find out that United created their own artist that sounds exactly like you, looks like you, is your brand basically, but it's just a different name or a different artist, then that's completely fine, and they're allowed to do that. You can't really sue them for that, or rather they make you legally acknowledge that and agree with the fact that the company receives many submissions, some of which may be similar. So in the off chance that you see an artist sign with United right after you, and you notice that this artist literally is your exact brand, and you think some dirty plays might have happened in the background, right here it's legally telling you that you've already acknowledged that this might happen, and you have nevertheless agreed to this agreement. So that's a little bit of a sketchy move.
All right, I already know a lot of people are going to hear basically the interpretation that George had, right? And I get it, right? That doesn't sound too cool from an artist standpoint, but from a business standpoint, I completely get it. Like, these types of distribution services or just companies that are dealing with a lot of artists, this is particularly the United Masters contract, and all these contracts are completely public, by the way. I wouldn't understand any other way to actually deal with something like that, actually, because you're dealing with a lot of artists on your distribution service. You don't even necessarily know who all of them are, probably, because there's a lot of artists that are coming in. Like, you're not day to day working with each one individually. So if some of them happen to be similar, you don't want to be liable to have to deal with that. Right? Maybe they go against each other if they have something going on, but that has nothing to do with you. You're not taking part in that necessarily part of business. Of course, the language does allow you to do something intentional, but just generally speaking, that's something that could just be there for the crazies who are looking to come at a big company because they have money and they see other things that are varying on a platform. So many artists have similar music. They just do. So I don't know on that one. But last but not least, and before I get into this last one, which is extremely important for you guys to just see and think about, that most people do not consider, I just want to make sure I thank George Fakis for doing this. If you want to get a contract explained to you in simple language, get understanding of loopholes and things involved, go over there to My Contract Explained. But without further ado, here's the last clip. It's an important one, y'all.
This specific agreement, any dispute or claim arising out of or in connection with these terms of service or the breach, termination, or invalidity thereof shall be finally settled by Swedish courts with the Stockholm District Court as the first instance unless otherwise provided by mandatory law.
The thing about this is obviously, all right, this is Swedish court. AWOL is... what is it? London? Like British court or something?
Either United or AWOL was British court.
United is American.
It's American. Okay.
AWOL. But we'll get into that when we talk about the AWOL one. But I'm saying that just because there's different courts and different laws, and I think we assume because everything is global and we have access to these things in different places, and it feels native. You're not thinking, oh, I'm dealing with a company from X. But if something goes down, that's when it gets real, where you have to actually deal with it in that place that company has chosen, right? To where things matter and where they'll litigate things. Because if you look at a situation like ASAP Rocky, he got arrested in Sweden over the summer.
Right.
The way a lot of things were getting handled were confusing for a lot of people looking from an American lens. Like, okay, this isn't going how we thought it should go. Obviously, of course, there were some other related things where you might be getting information out of context. But the point is understanding that these different courts do have different laws and different norms, right? So whatever seems to be right
exactly
from what you're used to might not be the right way. They have a different right way. So some of that could determine how you choose to deal with a company. You even hope to deal with the court in these situations? No, but just understand that that's where it could go. It's the network.